Law, and this summer I have both the honor and the privilege of working under the mentorship of Dr. Douglas Craig Cooper with the assistance of Ms. Emily Bondiorno, Ms. Rhonda Keene, and the Cancer Biology Department of Thomas Jefferson University College of Medicine. The title of my experiment is The Importance of a T-Vet Gene for TH1 Response in Mice. Before I delve into the specifics of my research, let me provide you some background information. Usually when cells divide and grow old, they go through apoptosis and new cells replace them, which is shown in this diagram. However, cancer cells continue to divide due to mutation in the cell, and then they cluster into tumors. Tumors can either be benign, meaning that they aren't cancerous, or malignant, meaning that they are cancerous. If malignant tumors grow large enough, they can be carried off by the circulatory system and travel to other parts of the body, which is shown here. A tumor starts off as a single cell with a genetic mutation. It can then develop into hyperplasia, which is increased cell development in a normal tissue or organ. Hyperplasia can either be benign, or it can become dysplasia, which is the abnormal growth in a tissue or organ, and it usually signifies the early stages of cancer. It can then become in situ cancer, or cancer that remains in one organ. If this tumor grows large enough, like mentioned before, it can be carried out by the circulatory system and travel to other parts of the body. Brain tumors make up 1% of all cancer diagnoses, and it can cause a wide variety of symptoms as it grows larger due to the amount of pressure that it puts on the brain. They're invasive, which means that it destroys normal cells throughout the brain as it grows. Over here is a brain tumor inside of the brain, shown in the X-ray. Gliomas are the most common type of brain tumors, and they're also the most dangerous because they express a protein called FastL, which can cause immune cells to commit suicide. They come from glial cells such as astrocytes. Astrocytes are star-shaped glial cells, which are shown here. They're responsible for cell repair and nutrient transport. Astrocyte tumors are tumors that arise from astrocytes, and they're classified by grades 1 through 4, grade 1 being the least aggressive grade, and grade 4 being the most aggressive grade. Glioblastomas also arise from astrocytes, and they're the most dangerous type of brain tumor, as these cancer cells can develop quickly and they're produced easily. They can also impair the immune response, which makes them hard to treat, and most people that develop glioblastomas have a low life expectancy. GL261 cells are cells that model glioblastomas, and they're implanted into the brains of mice in order to grow brain tumors. They grow quickly and they're easily reproducible, just like the cells that they model. They're created by injecting different carcinogens into the brains of mice, and which made the GL261 cells we use today. The immune system is a network of cells and tissues that work together in order to protect the body from harmful microbes, pathogens, and bacteria. The immune response is the body's immune response to a foreign pathogen. There are two types of immune responses. The innate response, which is the body's natural response to a foreign pathogen. And examples of this include coughing and letting out mucus. And then there's the adaptive response, which is usually acquired by vaccination, and it only attacks specific antigens. There are two types of adaptive responses. The antibody response, which is created by B cells, and the cell-mediated response, which is created by T cells. In this study, T cells are the main focus. T cells attack antigens by being macrophages, which is a type of white blood cell, and also assists in the B cell response. It can act as a mediator to immunity to tumors, as it uses cytokines to call out other immune cells to the site of the tumor in order to attack the brain cell, the tumor. CD8 cells are cytotoxic T cells, which means that they destroy infected and tumor cells. The main role of CD8 cells is to monitor the cells in the body and to be ready to destroy one that expresses a foreign gene. It directly attacks foreign antigens using cytokines and chemokines. TH1 and TH2 cells are helper T cells or CD4 cells. TH1 cells produce a pro-inflammatory response. However, too much of this response can cause tissue damage. It also activates macrophages and uses interferon gamma or INF gamma in order to carry out the response. It's also the only type of T cell that's able to enter the brain. TH2 cells use an anti-inflammatory response, which helps balance out the TH1 response, and uses interleukins or IL-4, 5, and 13 in order to do so. TBET is a major regulator of the TH1 response, meaning that it controls whether there is or is not a response. It's also responsible for the expression of chemokines in their receptors, and it uses backwards INF gammas. This brings me to my research design. Tibet team will affect the teacher in response from the brain of mice, which are mice with the Tibet team. We have hypothesized that since the T-Tone cells are the only type of T-cells that are able to enter the brain, there will be no T-cells in the Tibet knockout mice. These are the materials that I used for this experiment. Please take a moment to look over them. First, before my arrival, a scientist in my lab implanted 50,000 GLT6-1 cells into the right frontal cortex of the brains of mice. They then removed the blood from the mice by perfusing the mice and replacing the blood with PBS. They then took samples from the left cortex, the right cortex, the cerebellum, and the tumor, and they put them in tubes in order for me to do RNA extraction with them. I then made cDNA from the RNA in order to prepare the samples for qPCR. Before I did RNA extraction, I had to modify the samples. I added 600 microliters of Prizol to the cortex samples and 400 microliters to the cerebellum and tumor samples. I used the Prizol in order to keep the integrity of the RNA. I then used the needle and syringe in order to modify the sample, where I slowly inserted the needle into the tube. I used a syringe in order to slowly push up and down in order to push in and out the liquid and the sample in order to blend them with the Prizol. The first step in RNA extraction was to add chloroform to the sample and put it in the centrifuge for 12 minutes in order to separate the Prizol from the RNA. I then took the chloroform supernatant and added 70% ethanol to each of the samples in order to wash them. I then moved the samples to a 2 microliter column tube and started with DNase digestion. DNase digestion used enzyme called DNase in order to get rid of the DNA in the samples. After I did that, I washed the samples 3 times with a buffer called buffer RPE and centrifuged it after each wash. And then I let the RNA dry on its own without any liquid for 1 minute in order to dry the membrane. Finally, I diluted the samples by adding 50 microliters of water to each sample in order to let the RNA come down from the column tube. For the conversion of cDNA, I added water and RNA to those 40 microcentrifuge tubes, one for each sample, and I added different amounts depending on how concentrated the RNA was. And then I added 2 microliters of DNTP to each sample, which would provide all the necessary nucleotides for the conversion of cDNA. I then put the samples into a thermal cycler, which would heat up and cool down the samples in order to help the process of reverse transcription. I made the matrix while it was heating up, which consisted of many necessary materials. One of them was a reverse transcriptase, which was an enzyme that would assist reverse transcription. While the process was in the middle of cooling down, I popped the thermal cycler, and I added the master mix to each of the tubes, and then I continued the cycling. For qPCR, I had to find different types of genes in the samples. This included L13, which was a housekeeping gene, and it would help normalize the samples later on. CD4, CD8, and CD5 acted as T cell markers, the natural killer cell gene acted as a natural killer cell marker, and then CD19 and IgKappa acted as B cell markers and antibody markers, respectively. I used different standards, primers, and probes for each run that are specific to the gene that we were looking for. First, I made a master mix, which consisted of 660 microliters of water, 1,100 microliters of IQ supermix, which consisted of all the necessary polymerase of the nucleotides in order to quantify the DNA. And then I added 55 microliters of forward primer, reverse primer, and probe each. I added 17.5 microliters to each of the wells that I was going to add liquid in, and this was enough to pour 110 samples. I then added 2.5 microliters of standard cDNA and blaze into these wells. The standards went into the yellow well in the first row of here. cDNA went in the majority of these wells. One sample took up 2 wells in order to have duplicates. And the water that did as blades went into these last 2 wells. I then covered the samples and spinned them down in order to make sure that all the liquids were part of the reaction. And then I used a program called iCycler in order to set up the qPCR program. This will let me define what the standards, the samples, and the blanks were, and it will let me choose a color to dye the genes with thanks to the probe. For the process of qPCR, you start off with one strand of DNA. As the temperature went up, the two strands would separate themselves, and then when the temperature went down, the primers would attach themselves to the strands of DNA, and they would elongate and add nucleotides. The final product would be two new strands of DNA, and this cycle would repeat itself so that the amount of DNA would rise exponentially. After I completed each run, I had to analyze the results of the qPCR. The machine would give me a chart which consisted of the means of each of the separate wells, the starting quantities of each of the separate wells, and then the means of the starting quantities for each sample. The first gene I ran was L13, since it will help me normalize it later on. I took the means of the starting quantities for the L13 samples, and I recorded them onto one column of an Excel file. The next gene I ran was CE4. I took the starting quantity means of them and recorded them onto an Excel file as well. And then I wanted to find how much CE4 there was with it 1,000 copies of L13 in order to normalize the sample. I use this formula, starting quantity mean times 1,000 divided by the corresponding L13 in order to do so. I then graph the results and compare the wild type mice to the Tibet knockout mice. This brings me to my results. As mentioned before, CD4 and CD8 act as T cell markers. Over here, there's a lot of CD4 in the Tibet knockout mice. However, this is rather misleading and inaccurate, and this will be proven later on. CD8 had significantly more wild-type mice than there was in the Tibet knockout mice. The asterisk means that there was a significant difference statistically. CD5 is usually present where CD4 and CD8 is, meaning that if there actually was CD4 in the Tibet knockout mice, the amount of CD5 would be high as well. However, it isn't, which means that actually wasn't any CD4 in the Tibet knockout mice. And there's plenty of CD5 in the wild type mice, and this graph resembles a CD8 graph. Natural killer cells, there's plenty of it in both the wild type mice and the Tibet knockout mice. However, there's a little bit more in the wild type mice than there was in the Tibet knockout mice. CD19 acts as a B cell marker, and there was none present in either the wild type mice or the Tibet knockout mice, except for in the cerebellum of the Tibet knockout mice. IG kappa was an antibody marker, and there is some in the wild-type mice. However, there was almost none in the Tibet knockout mice. This brings me to my discussion. We hypothesized that since Th1 cells are the only T cells that are able to enter the brain, there would not be any T cells in the brain of Tibet knockout mice. This was accepted as there are less T cell markers and antibodies in the Tibet knockout mice rather than in the wild-type mice. For future research, we would like to see how the master enzyme of the Th2 response, GATA3, would affect brain tumors, and how Tibet affects other tumors throughout the body. These are the people that I would like to acknowledge for making this able to happen. Thank you. I would now like to open the floor to any questions, comments, and constructive criticism.